Hi, I'm James Harvey. I'm an interventional cardiologist. My partner, Dr. Ville Chowdhury, just demonstrated the unique functionality of our Canon 4D CT hybrid catheterization suite. I'm now going to show some case examples of how the use of intraprocedural CT guidance can optimize your outcomes for structural heart procedures. First case I want to show is a 74-year-old gentleman who came with cough and trace hemoptysis. Now, his cardiac history was fairly complex. About 6 years earlier, he was found to have an ascending aortic aneurysm, which was ultimately treated with an ascending aorta and arch replacement with a 32-millimeter gel-weave graft using the elephant trunk technique. This was staged for completion with an endovascular repair using a 38x200-millimeter endovascular graft for treatment of his ascending to descending aortic aneurysm. Unfortunately, this gentleman came back about a year later with chest pain and was found to have a new ascending aortic aneurysm involving his proximal ascending aorta, and ultimately he underwent a redo surgery with a root-sparing ascending aortic repair from his sinotubular junction to the previous repair. Given his extensive history, his provider referred him for a CT scan of the chest, which showed a 5x3x2 centimeter pseudoaneurysm arising from the suture line at his sinotubular junction. As you can see by the CAT scan here, on the left, you can see the ascending aorta and this large pseudoaneurysm arising from the suture line from the surgery at the sinotubular junction. This 3D reconstruction on the right just gives an idea of the size of this and the concern giving its anatomic features. Now, given this patient had already had two sternotomies and was considered a high risk given he'd be a third surgery, the heart team agreed that if we could repair this endovascularly, that would be ideal. So I brought this patient to our hybrid CT cardiac catheterization lab, and I ultimately was able to engage the pseudoaneurysm with a wire. You can see this pseudoaneurysm here off of the ascending aorta. I was able to selectively engage it and ultimately put in a delivery catheter where you now can see this filling, this opacification of the pseudoaneurysm. Based on CT measurements, once the delivery catheter was in the pseudoaneurysm, we decided to use an Amplatzer 8002 6x4mm ductal occluder device. You can see in this frame here, the distal disc is in the pseudoaneurysm. Ultimately, once we were able to deploy the proximal disc, you can see it looks like a pretty good result with the proximal disc right in the ascending aorta and the distal disc in the pseudoaneurysm. In this view, you can see another fluoroscopic angle, and again, it looked to be like an excellent seal with a proximal disc right here at the sinotubular junction. But given that this patient had already had two sternotomies, we thought that a pretty good assessment wasn't good enough, so we opted for an intraprocedural CT scan. What you see here is real-time footage of how we convert from a cardiac catheterization suite to an intraprocedural CT scan. What you can see here is the II moving to the side. Now you can see the team moving the patient towards the 4D CT scanner, and ultimately at this point, once the patient is positioned, we bring the 4D CT scanner to the patient and we're able to proceed with the intraprocedural 4D CT scanner. It takes us on average about 7.5 minutes to do a contrast CT. It takes about 2 to 2.5 minutes to do a non-contrast CT. On this patient, the intraprocedural CT demonstrated, as you can see here on the left, the cable still connected with excellent position of the device. More importantly, on the right, what you can see is that the device is sealed across here such that there is no dye going into the pseudoaneurysm, indicating an excellent seal. As such, based on this information, we went ahead and deployed the device and released it completely. You can see here, this is the device in stable position with the catheter being withdrawn. At 3-month follow-up, the patient was completely asymptomatic. We did repeat a 4D CT scan at that time. As you recall, this is what the 4D CT scan looked like pre-procedurally with this large pseudoaneurysm right here. His 3-month follow-up showed this, a very stable device with excellent position and complete resolution of the pseudoaneurysm, confirming an excellent durable result. Here is a second example of a case where intraprocedural CT scan can optimize your structural heart results. So this is a patient, a 78-year-old woman who presented with severe symptomatic aortic stenosis. Ultimately, after a heart team discussion, it was decided that she would benefit from a transcatheter aortic valve replacement using an Evolut platform. We are utilizers and, in fact, proctors for the cusp overlap technique. And if you're familiar with that, you can see here in this view, we have isolated the non-coronary cusp with overlap of the right and left coronary cusps. Ultimately, on deployment, you can see the transcatheter heart valve coming into position. At this point, we proceeded with deploying the valve. We looked here and I felt that we were deep, around 6 millimeters deep. My partner and I disagreed, and so we ultimately took another angiogram. And again, I said, you know, I think we're at 6 millimeters deep, and there was some disagreement there regarding this. So we said, you know what? We can't afford to be wrong here. Let's determine this objectively. So we proceeded with a 4D intraprocedural CT scan. What you see here is the first intraprocedural CT scan showing a partially deployed transcatheter heart valve prior to release of the device. You can see posterior to anterior, that's the descending aorta. You can see the connection cable coming down the ascending aorta down to connect with the device. Again, in the 3D reconstruction on the left here, you can see that we reconstructed the aortic annulus at the level of the aortic annulus. And you can see here this 3D reconstruction of the valve. But if you look on the right, what you see is we were able to objectively assess the depth at each of the cusps, most importantly at the non-coronary cusp. And again, our fluoroscopic view, which suggested 6 millimeters deep, was confirmed at 6.2 millimeters deep objectively using our 4D CT scanner. Because of this, we both agreed that the deployment was too deep, so ultimately we partially recaptured. As you can see here, we redeployed at a depth of 1 to 2 millimeters and ultimately released this with an excellent depth without conduction disturbance. This is the first in human intraprocedural CT-guided TAVR deployment. As you can imagine, this has spurred on the development of multiple investigator-initiated trials using this technology, two of which you see listed here. So in conclusion, I can tell you that intraprocedural CT guidance is both safe and does not impair with procedural efficiency. More importantly, it allows for optimal outcomes in structural heart procedures by providing real-time precision guidance for device positioning and deployment. Thank you very much.